Thank you so very much, Ken. Good to see you. Did everybody get one of the colorful handouts? These are specifically designed not to be recyclable. Ever since trees were mean to Sonny Bono, we want to. This does explain the next 10 years of American politics. And I want to talk a little bit about sort of where we're going in politics so we can have an argument about where we should be going. If you look at this map, the map here, red states, 24 red states, Republican governor, Republican legislature, both House and Senate. 11 blue states, Democrat House, Senate, Democrat governor. So in the red states, the Republicans can, if the Republicans get together, they can do anything they want. They can turn their state into Hong Kong or Texas. And in the blue states, if the Democrats all get together, they can turn themselves into Greece or California, and they're working at it. And the reason I bring this up is because people talk about Washington, D.C. And gridlock and the two parties not being able to agree. And in Washington, D.C., it's true that you have a Republican House, Democratic Senate, and Democratic President, and they can each veto something that the other one wants. And that will continue until one party or the other has control. At state level, you have just the opposite. You have a series of states that are Republican states that are moving towards changing their labor law, doing school choice, school reform, and tort reform, lower taxes, and the blue states that are working to increase their pension unfunded liabilities and raise their top marginal tax rates and give the trial lawyers what they want. And we're having a test to see what works. Okay, I mean, the 11 blue states, we'll see how they do. The 24 red states, we'll see how they do at the state level. But I show you this map also because this is what the country is probably going to look like for the next 10 years since the red states redistricted themselves at the state level to stay red states, and the yellow states are both houses Republican, and the blue states redistricted themselves to stay blue states. So the states that the Republicans run in terms of the legislatures will probably continue for 10 years, and the states the D's run will largely continue for the next 10 years. So you're going to have this division at the state level for 10 years. And we'll see how each one does. Also, these states redistricted for the Congress. And the Republicans picked up net 63 House seats in 2010, which gave them 242 majority in the House. They're going to hold that House not for 2 years or 4 years, but for the next 10 years, because when they redistricted in Pennsylvania and Ohio and Indiana and Michigan and Wisconsin, they didn't get greedy. They redistricted to make sure that all of their recent gains will stay recent gains. The Democrats may win a House seat or two. They may lose a House seat or two, but roughly the House is going to stay where it is in terms of a Republican majority and a strong Republican majority for the next decade. Now, when you turn on to the other side, we go through the Senate. There are 23 Democrats up this year in the Senate and 10 Republicans. 2 years from now, there are 20 Democrats up and 10 Republicans. So in the next two cycles, this election and 2 years from now, there are 43 Democrats up, half of whom are fairly vulnerable, and there are 23 Republicans up, two of whom are fairly vulnerable. Okay. So between this election cycle and the next one, you're going to end up with either a Republican majority in the Senate this cycle, or next cycle, a strong Republican majority. The reason why you have 43 Ds and only 23 Republicans the next two cycles is because these are the people who were elected in 06 and 08, the two very strong Democratic waves. Now, when Bush and Rove were doing this, some of us wondered in 2006, 2008 what they were thinking, but we can now cleverly see that the plan was to sneak up when the Democrats weren't looking and take those Senate seats back in 12 and 14. So as you move forward from now out, you're going to look at a Republican Senate, if not starting 2013, but 2 years from now and out several cycles as well, because of the ways that the nice people who who gerrymandered the states, and they created all those wonderful square states out west with three people who live in them, two of them are Republican senators and one's a Republican congressman, gives the Senate, in a bad year, the Republicans win 30 states in a presidential race, that should give you 60 senators if we could get word to North and South Dakota what their senators are doing in D.C. But that said, you're looking at a Republican Senate either now or starting in 2 years for some number of cycles, and a Republican House. then you have three bites at the apple for the presidency. This election, which is looking a lot better today than it was a month ago, and before somebody asks, I think Romney's like more likely to win than not. But there's this election in 12, there's one in 14, and there's one in 20. Each of those are going to end up with a period of at least 2 years, if not all 4 years, of a Republican House, Republican Senate, and Republican President, unless the Republicans lose the next three presidential races. During that period, they then pass the Ryan Plan. The Ryan Plan is taking on the tax level, 25% top rate corporate and individual, a territorial tax system, not a worldwide tax system. We have a worldwide tax system. The other major countries with a worldwide tax system are North Korea and Zimbabwe. It is not a wise idea. We shouldn't have one. It's a good idea to get rid of it. No European countries do this. And then our friends at the spending level are looking to reform all means-tested welfare programs the same way Clinton did in 96, which is you block grant them out to the states and allow them to grow with inflation, but not faster than that. You remove a lot of the strings, if not all of them, and say, here's all the Medicaid money we used to give you. It now grows with inflation and population, but we remove all of our strings telling you how to run your Medicaid program. Same thing with food stamps. There are actually 70 major means-tested welfare programs, 185 that we can count. All of them could be block granted. And then, of course, reforming Medicare to make it a premium support program where here's your basic support, and then you decide in the marketplace what kind of insurance, health insurance, you wish to purchase. Those reforms bring spending down from 24% of GDP now to 20% before within the decade, and to 16% as you go out to 2040, 2050. You don't slash government spending to bring spending down. You reform government programs to bring spending down. So when people say, what would you cut? The answer is you want to reform these programs. One of the things that we do is, you know, average pay in this country, private sector, $61,000. Pay, benefits, pensions, $61,000. Average state and local workers, total compensation package, $80,000 a year, $20,000 more. There are 19 million state and local employees. Federal workers make $120,000 for their whole package, on average. So if you total it together, the overpayment for government workers, not the payment to government workers, the overpayment for what people in the private sector get is about $500 billion a year. So when you talk about how can we reduce spending without cutting services, I'm not sure paying people more than the person who lives in the house next to them, giving them pensions that are gold-plated compared to the person who lives in the house next to them, is considered a service that the government pays for. So those are the reforms one is talking about in terms of reducing the cost of government, making it smaller. And I would argue that we will make that U-turn either with the 12 election or the 12 election with the addition of a Republican Senate in 14, or in 16, or in 20. And so that's what we're looking to do. Obviously, it's a lot more painful to wait 4 years and get 4 years deeper in debt before you begin to turn around the economy. And it looks more likely than not that we won't have to wait that long. So the challenge you have now at the national level, and this is where you get a lot of people who say, how come we have all this partisan bickering? How come we can't have what we used to have, which is bipartisan compromise? When somebody tells you this, what they've really told you is how old they are. Because they remember when the two parties were regional parties and everything was bipartisan, because 40 years ago, the liberal Republicans, Javits and Case, would get together with the liberal Democrats and they would fight the conservative Republicans and the conservative Democrats who lived in places like Texas and Georgia, and everything was bipartisan because the two parties didn't mean anything. They were regional. They were hangovers. They're the little old ladies in Mississippi who agreed with Ronald Reagan on absolutely everything, and they voted for George McGovern because Sherman had been mean to Atlanta recently. And so when you've got these sort of you're a Republican. Oh, you must have been born north of the Mason-Dixon line. I know nothing else about you. How are you today? Okay. We now have parties where if somebody tells you they're a Republican or Democrat, you have a pretty good idea where they stand on size of government questions. There are a whole host of social issues that wash back and forth between the two parties. Do you want higher taxes and more spending or lower taxes and less spending? You've got 98% certainty when you're looking at elected officials within the two parties. And that's why, as you mentioned, when I went to candidates and said, I have a pledge here that you can sign to the voters, not as Harry Reid or Vice President Biden suggests, a pledge to me personally, but a pledge to the voters of their state and the American people that they'll oppose and vote against tax increase. When I get to Washington or the state capitol and I see a problem, I'm going to reform government. I'm not going to go to the people of Kansas or the people of the United States and raise their taxes to pay for our problem. I'm going to reform government so that it costs less. So if you want to know what I'm going to do when I go to Washington, I'm going to reform government so it costs less. I am not coming to you to pay for the mistakes of the past and to paper over and pay for decisions that other people have made in the past. So what we have now is all but six Republicans in the House have made that commitment. Almost all the Republicans in the Senate, 1,300 state legislators, quite a number of governors, have made that commitment to the point where the modern Republican Party has largely branded itself as the party that will not raise your taxes. They may do other things, they may invade countries they can't pronounce, but they will not raise your taxes. And that's been a very, very helpful thing for the Republican Party in terms of explaining who it is to itself. And they kept that commitment. And one of the reasons they kept that commitment is George Herbert Walker Bush, who ran for office, signed the pledge, made the commitment, verbally reiterated that at the convention, and then he raised taxes. And he had a very successful presidency judged by recent standards. He managed the collapse of the Soviet Union without a lot of blood on the floor. He drove Iraq out of Kuwait and didn't get stuck occupying the place for a decade. He had lots of success. One slight problem, he raised taxes, one hole in the bottom of the boat sank. And other Republicans looked over and said, let's see, he took the pledge and beat Dole, who he was losing to until he took the pledge. And then he was 17 or 14 points behind Mike Dukakis. And then he said, I'm never raising your taxes. And he beat him by 8 points. Take the pledge, win the primary. Take the pledge, win the general. Break the pledge, lose the next election. I got it. Take the pledge and keep it. And that's when we started getting 90, you know, ivory soap numbers of Republicans taking the pledge and keeping it. This isn't a trick to get into the office. This is, don't take the pledge if you don't mean it, because if you don't mean it and you take it and you break it, this is what happened with George Bush. Look, nobody's life is a complete waste. Some people serve as bad examples. And so small children, don't do that, okay? See what Bush did? Don't do that. It's not good. And it doesn't work out well and ends poorly. And that has branded the modern Republican Party as the party that won't raise your taxes. Just like Coca-Cola, right? You go to the store, you can pick up a Coke. You can pick up a bottle of Coke and take it home. You don't sit here and read the ingredients. You know, they have quality control. You know what's in there. You don't have to ask your friends, what do you think of this? Or could I have a taste of this before? You know what it is. You take it home. But if you get your bottle of Coke and you take it home and you're two-thirds of the way through it and you look down and there's a rat head in what's left of your bottle, you don't say to yourself, you know, I'm thinking I may not finish all the rest of this Coke today. You wonder whether you're going to drink Coke in the future. And you go on local TV and show them the cool rat head and put on Facebook. And Coke has a big problem, okay? Because brands matter. And it damages the brand when you find one rat head in one Coke, even though there are millions of Coke. Republican elected officials who vote for tax increases are rat heads in a Coke bottle. They damage the brand for everyone else. This is not a victimless crime. There's Johnny over in the corner raising taxes. How sad for him and his family. No. This confuses small children about the nature of the world. And therefore, it's very important that people in who intend, every once in a while, some Republicans, I don't want to take the pledge. I said, good, then don't. If you think you want to go and raise taxes, do not sign the pledge. I don't want you messing the pledge by taking it because you think you're just going to get through the election and then raising taxes. Don't take the pledge if you don't mean it, which is why it confuses politicians in Washington that these people ran on something and kept their word, which isn't what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to tell the yokels anything it takes to get to Washington, and then the smarter people who have columns in the Washington Post will explain to you how you should be voting on things. And all these lovely lobbyists who make a lot of money talking to you, they can't even, they're going to call you on the phone and say, I have a tax increase idea. I took the pledge. Okay, they can't make a living lobbying if you've taken that off the table. So official Washington, very unhappy with the whole idea of people making commitments to voters and keeping them. They wouldn't mind if you fibbed and then you went to Washington. What they mind is that people make the commitment, it's in writing, they keep it, and that has stopped tax increases. People talk about the argument we had in 2011 where Republicans wanted $2.5 trillion spending reduction over the next decade, and Obama wanted tax increases for most, if not all, of that $2.5 trillion. And the Republicans said, no, we have to have spending cuts. And at the end of the day, we got spending cuts and no tax increases. And I have to listen to people in Washington going, well, that was a failed negotiation. No. No, see, I won. Those of us who didn't want tax increases won. We got spending cuts and not a tax increase. It is true that you failed to get a tax increase. You didn't fail to get an agreement. You got an agreement you didn't like. We didn't raise taxes. We did cut spending. So that was the fight. And obviously, the folks who wish there'd been a tax increase blame the pledge. Look, politics is different when you have two parties that mean something. When the two parties didn't mean anything, they were just regional, they could get together. And you know, they always had bipartisan agreements. Nixon wanted a bigger government, and Teddy Kennedy wanted a much bigger government. And every year they'd sit down and negotiate, and come up with a bigger government, somewhat bigger government. Not as big as Teddy wanted, bigger than Nixon wanted, but bigger. And since they were always moving in the same direction, they could compromise. We're gonna go that far. No, we're gonna go this far. Well, we're all heading in that direction. So they compromised to bigger and bigger and bigger in government. Well, if one party wants smaller government and one party wants bigger government, if one party wants to go west and one party wants to go east, what would a compromise look like? What are they talking about? Why can't you just sit down and compromise? Well, the Democrats want to raise taxes and spend more money, and the Republicans want to cut taxes and spend less money. What are you talking about in terms of a compromise? They're going in different directions. And so that's what the fight is in Washington, D.C., and the two parties are not agreeing. I think we're going to elect the Republican president, House and Senate, this cycle, or 2 years from now, or 4 years from now, and you pass the Ryan plan, which doesn't raise taxes, gives you a pro-growth tax code, and it fixes entitlements so the government costs less while not slashing and cutting budgets, just as Clinton did with welfare reform. But now that the Republicans want to take his idea, which he may have borrowed from Ronald Reagan in 1972, lock, stock, and barrel, but that's, we'll give it Clinton credit for it because that makes it bipartisan. And so we take Clinton's idea and expand it to the other means-tested welfare proposal. So what we're going to do is we're going to fight at the national level until one team or the other gets to move the ball right or to the left. But at the state level, this is where all the cool, interesting stuff has been happening for the last several years. And for the next several years, whatever happens in Washington, I mean, in Utah, they passed a law starting in July of this year. In Utah, all new hires for government, teachers, police, firemen, all state, county, local officials, have a defined contribution 401k. Here's your pay. Here's 10% of your pay in a 401k. We're even. You want to stick around for 20 years? We can do that. You want to leave tomorrow? You've got your pension. You've got your pay. And we're cool. There are no more unfunded liabilities being created in Utah. Okay, that is somebody sitting down and fixing a problem. Louisiana did something very similar to that. A number of other states are all looking at Utah and are going to follow what Utah did. Massive scholarship school choice programs passed in Indiana and Louisiana and now Arizona. Half of the kids in Indiana and Louisiana in the next year and a half, 2 years, it builds up, will be able to take a $5,000 scholarship to any school they want. They like the public school, they get to the public school. They want a different public school, they want to go to private school, whatever they want to do, they can take that with them. Arizona actually, I think, did a better thing. They have 100,000 kids are going to get scholarships, $5,500 scholarships. But they did something that other states will now follow, and that is You take your $5,500 voucher scholarship to a private school or a public school, and if they only charge $4,000, you take the $1,500 and put it in your education savings account towards college. So all of a sudden, you have cost competition between the public-private schools, not just quality competition, but also cost competition. And parents can begin to save for their kids' education. So these sorts of tort reform is happening in red states and not happening in blue states. There are a whole bunch of things. Now, if somebody's a committed left-of-center guy, this is great. We're going to make everybody want to live in Illinois and California. And I say, good luck. And maybe, okay, try it. Do it. But don't tell me you want to experiment on the whole country until you've, what is it, the El Salvador guy said when we were trying to do land reform in El Salvador, they said, could you try that out in a small state like Vermont first before you impose it on us? Okay, try it in Vermont before you want to make the whole country do some of this stuff. And that's what we're going to have, both from conservative free market approaches and left of center, more statist approaches. We'll be able to see which things work and which ones don't. So I think we can have a very friendly competition at the state level, while at the federal level, we play tug of war to see whether we're going to move to bigger government or smaller government. And this is the next 10 years of states, and this is the next 10 years of the House Senate, with three presidential elections in the middle of it, and it's going to be exciting. Questions, thoughts, arguments? Sir?
Yeah, you say you've won, and maybe you have.
I don't think we've won yet, but go ahead.
Your point. What you didn't say is whether the United States won or lost. But let me ask you this question. In the Times today, a large group of major CEOs urged that to avoid the fiscal cliff, that there be both spending cuts and also, So these CEOs said you got to have spending cuts, but you also have the increases in taxes. Would you be against that?
Okay. Couple of things. One, they actually cleverly didn't say they were for tax increases. They said they were for revenue increases. I'm for revenue increases. I'm for cutting the corporate and the individual rate 25% because I think you would get more growth. And if you grow at 3% a year for a decade instead of 2% a year for a decade, the government takes $2.5 trillion in additional taxes. Okay, you have more growth. The federal government walks away with $2.5 trillion for every 1 point in more growth. I think you get more growth by cutting the capital gains tax, cutting marginal tax rates, taking the trial lawyers and putting them in plastic bags and dropping them in the Hudson. I mean, there are a whole series of pro-growth policies, all of which give you more growth and more revenue. I read the letter that the CEO signed. I could have signed that letter. That's fine. Revenue is good. Tax rate increases, tax increases are not a good idea. They actually didn't call for that, which I thought was helpful and interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks. So, viewed through the prism of Americans for tax reform, would you view George W. Bush's administration over 8 years as a success since he cut taxes but grew government?
No, because there are two steps to increasing human liberty. One is don't raise taxes. The other is stop spending so much money. And George Bush got the first one mostly right, okay? Don't raise taxes. Got it. Remember what Dad did? Don't do that. But he allowed government to grow. And I talked to Mitch Daniels, who was his OMB director, within weeks of his coming in. And I said, what's the metric you're going to use? What, you know, if you don't measure it, you don't get it, right? What's the metric you're going to use? Spending as a percent of GDP, total full-time equivalents at the federal level. You're going to try and phase out the number of federal employees, replace three who leave with two. What's the metric? Oh, yeah, we ought to have one of those. It wasn't on the list of things to do, in a sense. Every crisis Bush faced, he spent more money. Every single one. Never let a good crisis to waste, Rahm Emanuel's comment. And people make fun of that, but the American people are willing to change when there's a crisis. So say, this is why we need to spend less. Lower taxes, these sorts of things. Truman, the North Koreans invade South Korea, and Truman cut all the budgets accept the defense budget by 25% because we had a crisis. That's not what Bush did. He plussed up everything else while you had a crisis after September 11th. So, no, the huge, huge problem of spend too much. Now, when Obama came in and really spent a lot more, I thought it would take until spend too much turned into tax increase for people to react. The Tea Party movement, I would have told you, couldn't happen, wouldn't happen. The American people would not rise up in opposition to an aggregate number, spend too much, okay? They did. Very interesting. In the modern Republican Party, which had learned don't raise taxes, then got a 2x4 right in the forehead, don't spend so much, and is a different Republican Party, committed to not doing earmarks, which used to be considered, you know, droit de seigneur material. I mean, you know, that's why you go to Washington, so you can do this stuff. But they don't now. And they're actually committed and all voted for the Ryan Plan, which is a dramatic restructuring of, I mean, not just touching the third rail of American politics, entitlement, they're in there fondling the third rail of American politics. And the American people go, yes, good. One of the columnists said the thing that won was Ryan. Who's won this election? Ryan, because he showed that you can be for Medicare reform and not lose votes because of it. I mean, we're carrying Florida because we have a plan to save Medicare, which is not the way everybody in Washington thought it was going to run. They thought it'd be the opposite. Discuss Medicare, you old people get scared. It's not what it was. It's actually turned quite the opposite way. So spend too much is key as a mistake. We need to focus on spending restraint. The modern Republican Party, post-Bush, learned that. Now, Bush had lots of distractions, September 11th being one of them. But the modern Republican Party is not, I think, ever going to back off of the focus on spending, and that's why it's a much healthier and stronger party than it was 5 years ago. Yes?
It's certainly, you'd say we've seen it already, but it's certainly possible for the government to make the mistake of spending too much and taxing too much. But it's also maybe a little hard to see today, but it's completely conceivable that they could one day spend too little and tax too little, or spend too little or tax too little, one of the combinations. But the pledge is completely unconditional. What happens in a world where, say, we get so swept up in the success of the pledge and of the program of reducing spending, reducing taxation, seeing the benefits, et cetera, what happens if we go too far? Is there a mechanism to essentially say, okay, guys, you know, the pledge is off for a while, so that we can get back up to a responsible level of either spending or taxes, whichever one went too low?
Yeah, you know those guys who wore the tin hats to stop the Skylab from hitting them on the head? Okay. I'm not terribly worried that in the next 10 or 20 or 30 years, we're going to end up with a government too teeny. I mean, it's going to take decades for the entitlement reform to wash through and reduce the size and scope of government. This is not, Ryan's plan does not go to somebody and say, see that number, cut it in half kind of thing. It says, why don't we restructure these programs so that over time, cost competition in healthcare drives down costs instead of having some bureaucracy impose wage and prices on stuff. And that takes longer to do. So I'm not worried that's going to happen. But that said, the pledge is for as long, if you run for Congress, the pledge is for as long as you're a congressman. If you then run for the Senate, it's for as long as you're a Senate. So it cycles through, and you have new people elected who either do take the pledge or don't. We get to the point where government's down to, you know, where it was for three quarters of American history at about, you know, 4% of GDP, or down to where it was at the time when we couldn't take it anymore because the Brits were being outrageous, stealing between 1% and 2% of GDP. Was the American tax rate was 1% to 2% of GDP when we had a revolution over taxes. When we get down to that point, it gets too much. I think we'll have plenty of time to rethink stuff. But the reduction in the cost of government is so gradual that it drives a lot of my friends nuts. But I'm much more interested than in the direction and moving for a long time in that direction than trying to solve everything tomorrow, which I don't think works well. Yes, sir.
take us through scenarios of what you think happens in Washington post-election day based on
sure.
what happens on election day?
Yeah. I think there are two scenarios. One is Romney wins with the Republican House and Senate. They hold a press conference 3 days later and announce they're going to take all of the expiring tax provisions and extend them a year or two. And during that time, they do tax reform. 25% top rate corporate and individual, territorial, boom. And entitlement reform on the Ryan plan. Boom. Then, okay, so that's if the Republicans win. If Obama gets reelected, or you have a Democratic Senate. Well, we've been here twice now already. 2 years ago, we faced a fiscal cliff identical to the one we have now, where all the Bush tax cuts were going to disappear on January 1st, 2011. And Obama was going to sit there and force us to have the top rate go up. And the Republicans won the House, but the Democrats had the Senate and the presidency, just like our scenario. Okay, president and or Senate. But the Republicans are stronger in the House, the economy's weaker than it was then, and the Democrats are weaker in the Senate than they were 2 years ago. What will happen? Same thing happened 2 years ago. Now, not because the president's scared about getting reelected, which is why he folded 2 years ago, but because 20 Democrats in the Senate, many of them are not coming back if they tank the economy by pulling this kind of stunt now. So those 20 senators go, Mr. President, we helped you by extending the tax cut for 2 years. You will now do this for us. And then you have the fact that the Republicans run the House of Representatives. They gave the president a 2.5 year long leash when they gave him the increase in the debt ceiling in return for $2.5 trillion in spending cuts over a decade. If the president got reelected and you have a Republican House, how long do you think the president, how long do you think his leash would be? How about what they did for the first couple months of 2011, was they give him the debt ceiling increase, well, it's a continuing resolution, but the debt ceiling gives you the same power, maybe more. Week at a time, 2 weeks at a time. He had to pay every time he got a continuing resolution for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. And the Republicans did that for a while and then insisted on everything at once and then only got half of what they asked for. This time around, they'll go, you got a month. These are the things we want. You got a month of more spending. And one of the first things they'd insist on is a continuation of the tax increases. So the strength that the Republicans have on debt ceiling, they're never going to give them 2.5 years of leeway again. They're not giving them a year. They're not giving them 6 months. And he's going to have to pay for everyone he gets. He can be a very unhappy camper over the next 4 years. It's not all is going to be as much fun as the first 2 years. So to save him that pain, I think we'll beat him in the general election. In the way back.
I guess I agree with you that based on redistricting and
gerrymandering that's gone on in 2010, 2011, at the state level, that you know, your map is pretty well locked in mm-hmm. for the next 10 years. But there are some major Democratic shifts, demographic shifts that are happening in the South, North Carolina, even Georgia, Texas, Arizona. So that when the next census comes about, how do you lock in, or can you lock in,
yeah.
I hope as a Democrat that you don't lock in, how do you do that when clearly these red states aren't as red as your map makes them appear.
Yeah, or won't be in 10 years. Okay.
Right.
Two things. When Democrats talk, this is a fascinating question, and there are two pieces to it. Because when Democrats talk about demographics, they mean race, ethnicity, gender, income. When and Republicans see that too. But the demographics I'm more interested in, because you can change them, are behavioral demographics. But let's start with the ones the D's look at. They go, well, 10 years from now, they're going to be X number of Hispanics in Texas, and they've been voting D, and then they take over. Okay, unless the Republican Party quits spitting at them. Okay, step one, quit spitting at them. Okay, it's very important that the modern Republican Party split the Hispanic vote 50-50 moving forward. They got 10 years to get smart. Okay, it doesn't have to happen tomorrow, but they don't got more than 10 years. And it's a lot easier and better if they start tomorrow being smarter about this. I think they will. Texas, The Texas Republican Party chairman is the most pro-immigrant party chairman in the country, okay? Florida, Rubio. You're looking at a modern Republican Party that is shifting on this issue, that realizes the Republican Party has nominated the most pro-immigrant presidential candidate since Reagan, every time we had a fight. We nominated McCain, who is most famous for being for leaky borders, okay, 4 years ago. Romney's a Mormon, the most pro-immigrant church in the country, the Mormon church. Utah passed a state, you've heard the be mean to immigrant law they have in Arizona that they call something else, okay. The Utah passed a law, which is a worker permit, state law. So, you know, the Utah said, I'm sorry, Arizona said, you feds, you have your immigration policy, we have our own. So did Utah. Utah's is immigrant friendly. So I think that the modern Republican Party can, out of its own self-interest slash because it's the right thing to do, move on the immigration issue, which is, and some Republicans go, oh, Grover, we're going to go to the Hispanics and say, you go to church, we go to church. You're pro-family, we're pro-family. You're pro-life, we're pro-life. Why don't you vote with us? Now, while we talk about all the things we agree on, you won't mind if Igor here goes upstairs, grabs your mother, drags her down the stairs, and throws her across the border, will you? Because that shouldn't get into interfere with us talking about all the issues that unite us as political activists, right? No. You don't have that conversation until you deal with the immigration issue. So the good news is that while we've been doing this last Friday. Today's Friday? Yeah. Today's Thursday. Okay. A week ago, Friday. I was in Indiana. We had a meeting of 300 people. Bibles, badges, business. All pro-immigrant Republicans. Bibles, all the evangelicals and the Catholics. Badges, the cops and the Attorney General of Indiana and Utah. And business guys who want more people to come in. The high-tech guys who can't find engineers that they need, and the farmers, and everybody else who's short workers. So there's a development there within the modern Republican Party that is extremely healthy dealing with the Hispanic vote. And I believe we will get there, and I consider it a key central issue. But then there are other demographics, okay? Homeschoolers. I serve on the board of the parental rights organization, the homeschool political operation. 2.5 million people are homeschooling right now, kids being homeschooled. About 2.5 million parents. 10 million Americans have been homeschooled at some point in their life. This was illegal in all 50. People going to prison in all 50 states 25 years ago for homeschooling. Okay, it's now legal in all 50 states. It's 2% of the population, but they are 100% Republican voting bloc because their central vote moving issue, the teachers union, wants to destroy that part of their life that's most important to them. And the Dems can do many things, but they can't cross the teachers unions. What was the first thing Obama did when he came into Washington, D.C.? I'm from D.C., I live in D.C. The 3,000 kids in private going to private schools because the Republicans created a voucher program for them through Congress, he killed it. Kids wanted to go to private, wanted vouchers, the parents wanted to go to vouchers, poor kids. And the teachers union didn't, and it took Obama all of 2 seconds to go, screw the kids, I'm with the teachers union. And so the homeschoolers know that the same thing is in store for them. The Second Amendment community, I know this isn't big in New York City, yes, have the Solomon Law, but in the rest of the country, 41 states have shall issue concealed carry laws. 8 million people have concealed carry permits and carry a gun anywhere they want with them, and do, okay? Now, I serve on the board of the National Rifle Association, and I know that everyone thinks that has to do with hunting and everything, and I'm for hunters, okay? Every year, they go out and irritate Bambi's relatives for a couple weekends. But if you want to know who's going to protect the Second Amendment, it's the concealed carry permit people, and that's growing and deepening, and not only reducing crime dramatically in the states with concealed carry permits compared to the ones that only recently got concealed carry or don't have concealed carry, shall issue concealed carry. That's an incredible demographic, and it votes 80% R. Okay. So then if you have $5,000 worth, this Scott Rasmussen does some wonderful numbers on the investor class. If you have $5,000 worth of stock, it makes you 18% more Republican, less Democrat, on average. Okay. Rich people, poor people, white, black, government worker, private sector, retired worker, whatever it is, on average, they move over 18% more Republican than D than they otherwise would be given their other demographics. If you have $5,000 or more in a 401k, changes who you are. If you are investing for your future and you see the stock market do stuff and you realize that's you and it matters and the capital gains tax matters and the corporate income tax matters and stuff like that. There's one demographic group that doesn't get any better with share ownership. They're already mostly Republican, but these are women who make more than $75,000 a year. So if you know any women like this, don't give them any stock because it doesn't do any good. But if you buy them a gun, it's a big help.
We have time for one or two more questions.
Yes.
Short one. What do you think of the flat tax?
I'm in favor of moving towards a flat tax. What I would like to move towards is taxing income, consumed income, one time at one rate. Okay. So that right now we tax you when you earn it, when you save it, when you invest it, when you put it in a company, when you get a dividend. If you're stupid enough to die, we take half. Okay. Is it, look, watch me earn a dollar and take some and go away, or watch me spend a dollar, fair tax, sales tax, spend a dollar, take some and go away. One or the other, but not again and again and again and at the same rate. The reason you want one rate is not because it's fair. Okay, taxation consists of taking money from people who earned it and giving it to somebody else. Fairness is not part of this equation. Okay, but the reason you want a flat tax, and I'm originally from Massachusetts prior to emigrating to the United States, and we have a flat rate tax by constitution, single rate tax. You have to have a flat rate tax. Five times they put on the ballot in Massachusetts a graduated tax, grad tax, or a progressive income tax. Five times liberal Teddy Kennedy, George McGovern, Massachusetts voted it down. Because they said, if you divide us into different groups with different rates, you'll mug us one at a time. Okay, and the whole, this is the Richard Speck theory of tax increases. If you can't take on everyone in the room at once, you take them out of the room one at a time. We don't want to do that. We want the politicians to have to face us all. I've got a great idea, and you're all paying for it. Well, then we're all listening. So tell us about it. But if I've got a great idea, and I'm only going to mug these two guys, so the rest of you don't matter, that's how government grows. So the reason for a flat tax is so that everybody faces the same government.
Do you think it'll happen?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, yeah. Look, there are 20 countries with a flat tax now. I mean, a lot of the former Eastern European countries have gone to flat. If you were starting from scratch, you'd do a flat tax. A lot of states have flat taxes. Illinois has got a flat tax. Massachusetts has a flat tax. 9 states with no income tax have a flat tax. Zero, but flat. yes, but yes.
In your modern Republican organization, how do you envision us supporting the military engagement that we have all over the world and a war? How do you reconcile, and how long do you think modern Republicans would be able to move in ending the military spending?
Yeah, I think that the modern Republican Party needs to look at military spending with the same jaundiced eye that we look at all other spending. Okay, we make fun of liberals who say, oh, we're going to spend this money on education. Therefore, you have to judge us by our intentions rather than by whether kids learn anything. Okay, no, you want, if somebody says we're going to spend money on defense, the question is, what are you trying to do? What is the goal? Why are you spending the money? And we need to be very serious. There's legislation that's moving through Republicans to audit the Pentagon. It's the one part of the government we don't audit now. We should, okay? And we need to audit it. We need to take a look at it. The guy who was doing the books for Bush tells me, Dov Zakheim, who's a key advisor to Romney, that there's several hundred thousand civilian employees in the Pentagon that you could do without and still have a strong military. That's a lot of money to save. Not tomorrow, but over time. You don't rehire the people. So there's a lot of money to be saved. We should never, I mean, I'm all for a strong national defense. The Canadians keep me up at night. I want them on their side of the border. And I think we need a military to make sure that stays the way it is. But you can't just say defense and insist that people throw money at it. The ancient Egyptians used to.
That wasn't my question.
What was it?
As a modern republic,
right.
How do you vision taking down the bloat in our federal government and the military? That's the question. How do you envision?
Well, two things. You start, because we're not there with all the Republicans, by saying you judge the military the same way you judge the welfare department or the school district by whether they're doing what they say they're going to do, not just by saying, I'm for X. Oh, well, that's a good thing, okay? I mean, the ancient Egyptians used to do this thing where they'd bring cooked food and put it in front of Isis, right, Isis? And Isis, this big statue, stone statue, would absorb the essence of the food. And then when you went home, the high priest came out and ate all the food. Okay. We do that with the teachers' union. We bring all these piles of money and put them in front of the education statue, and then we leave, and the teachers' union come out and take all the money. And some of the guys in the Pentagon do the same thing. Just because you call it defense or call it education doesn't mean that money put in front of the stone statue actually does that. And so, I mean, so step one, it's a modest step, except it's without which you don't get there, which is understand that defense is just as subject to abuse as other parts of the budget, and we need to be serious. And if we're going to engage in wars, you better answer the question of why you're doing it, how long are you going to be there, why you're there, what does winning look like, and when do we not stay there? Okay. And if you can't answer those questions, rethink.
That I agree.
Jerome?
Thank you. If Romney does win the election, how much of the Affordable Health Care Act do you think will be able to repeal?
One can repeal all of the, you need 60 votes to change policy in the Senate, okay, you have to have 60 votes. Or you need 51 votes if you can do it inside reconciliation. If it's a budgetary question, you can do it with 51 votes. So if he gets elected with 50 Republicans plus a vice president or 51 Republicans, he can, with 51 votes, repeal all of the 20 taxes in Obamacare, repeal all of the spending, okay? The two that somebody has told me that you might have to do differently are the way they handle pre-existing conditions and 26-year-olds living at home, staying on your insurance. Are those policy questions? Other people say, no, those are policy questions with clear spending implications. So if you have the right guy in the Senate answering the question, is this germane, and he says yes, then you can do that. So you should be able to, the answer is almost all immediately, or all. And there's some slivers of it that you might want to redo. Now, as Romney has said, and as the Republicans have said, while they want to get rid of that, they want to reform Medicare, Medicaid, they want to do tort reform, they want to do a whole bunch of things that will reduce costs, including allowing New Yorkers to buy health insurance from companies based in Kansas that don't have all of the mandated benefits and expenditures that you have here or in New Jersey. It costs less to buy health insurance in Kansas because you don't have to buy for all sorts of things that you might not want to pay for chiropractic, those sorts of things. And so the estimate was by the government that it would drop the cost of healthcare 15%, health insurance, to allow that kind of competition. Not telling anybody no about anything, but letting actual consumers decide what they want to buy in the way of insurance. So the answer is you can do, if not all of it, 99% of it the first day. And I think it's that you can do all of it over fairly quickly.
Okay.
Do you want to?
Dr. Fass?
Bringing it back to your division of the country between red and blue, black and white, you make it very clear, and I think in some circumstances do a disservice to fiscal conservatism because it's not so simple. Let's look at H.R. 5. Republican House, tort reforms on the table, Republican administration, back when George Bush was president. Did tort reform move forward on a national level? New York State, which on this map here looks red, excuse me, blue. Or, no,
it's white. It's divided, House and Senate.
So, but it has had tort reform. Mm-hmm. Not meaningful enough, but they've moved forward with a Democratic governor. So do you think that we could really separate each issue by virtue of whether you're red or blue?
Not all issues, but tort reform largely. Now, at the federal level, tort reform, again, at least the way the guy in the Senate, the parliamentarian, has interpreted it, is not considered a budgetary issue. So it requires 60 votes. And one of the challenges Bush had was that even when he had a 51 vote majority in the Senate first year, and then a 55 vote majority after the 2004 election in the Senate, he never had 60. Okay, and there was, Presidents don't like to say, I have failed to do X, or I can't do X, because they think of themselves as, they don't like to say that. But if you want the American people to understand why you've been president for 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, 8 years, and the world hasn't been fixed, you've got to say, I wanted to get this, but it took 60 votes, and I couldn't do it. Okay? This is the argument I had with, Ken's left. Smartest guy in the White House called me right after the 2004 election and said, we're gonna privatize Social Security just like Chile. It's going to be great. And I said, no, it's not. There are 55 Republican senators. Take 60, the diesel filibuster. They've announced it. You're not going to, no, we've got 6 or 8 Democrats who've been willing to reform Social Security. You have 6 or 8 Democrats who've been willing to raise taxes or cut benefits, which are the two reforms you've said you're not going to do. You want to personalize it so people have 401ks, make it defined contribution, not cut and tax. And no, we're going to get this. Look, the modern Democratic Party cannot survive if every 20-year-old looks forward to saving $500,000 in a 401k through FICA taxes and Social Security. It just can't. It'll be gone. Because the modern Democratic Party has nothing to make your 401k bicker. They tax it. They sick the labor unions on it. The lawyers sue it. There's nothing that they do to make your 401k bigger. The Republicans have nothing but ideas for making your 401k bigger. They stay up at night thinking of ways to make your 401k bigger and stuff. So the modern Democratic Party is going to filibuster anything to reform Social Security so that every American retires with significant quantities of money, even low-income people saving 10% of their salary, FICA taxes, but in a 401k, not sending it to Washington. And we couldn't talk the Democrats, I explained, you're not going to be able to talk the Democrats into doing this. There's that wonderful scene where Hannibal Lecter in Silence of the Lambs talks the guy in the prison cell next to him into swallowing his tongue and killing himself. Okay, we weren't that good. We couldn't talk the Democrats into voting themselves out of existence by the trial lawyer labor union party is a dead man walking the day we get Social Security privatization, or everybody with a 401k or a defined contribution pension. And they're not going to do that to themselves for us. We're going to have to beat them and then fix it.
But you still really haven't answered the question, why can't you?
Because some things need 60 votes. Ours never had 60 votes. You couldn't do tort reform at the national level without 60 votes. You can do it at the state level. They're passing it in lots of red states. Of course, you have some Supreme Courts that need to be fixed, too. But at the state level, we're... I mean, state Supreme Courts that turned it down. Sure, you choose. I'll just get in trouble.
If all you care about is taxes, have you been pushing for Republicans to become more moderate in their social views?
Okay.
People like myself onto the Republican?
Yeah. Okay, I run Americans for Tax Reform. I don't, not an elected official, I don't have to have opinions on everything. Which makes it easier. But that said, I don't only care about taxes. I walk through several of the subjects of Second Amendment I consider to be key, and the homeschooling movement and school reform is, I think, very important, even though they're not technically tax issues. I think the modern Republican Party is, you have people on all sides of a lot of those issues, but the one issue where you don't have any R's that want to raise taxes. You do have R's on all sorts of questions of marriage equality or other issues like that where you do have divisions. I'm on the board of directors of board of advisors of GL Proud, which is the gay Republican group. So I think it's very important that the Republican Party's very open to everybody.
Clover, you've said very famously that you'd like to see government drown in the bathtub and take us back to 1900 before Medicare, Social Security, unemployment insurance, the Environmental Protection Agency, the SEC. Can you just talk to that? Are you serious about wanting to really eliminate government to that degree?
Okay. The actual quote is no, because it's you got part right. It is the goal is to drop the size of government as a percentage of GDP in half over the next 25 years. So in a generation, to take government spending, federal, state, and local, from 33% of GDP, more now under Obama, to half over a 25-year period by reforming things like schools and entitlements so that they cost less. Then when somebody said to me on NPR following that, so you want to have no government? And I said, no, we don't want no government. We just want it small enough so you could drag it into the bathroom and drown it in the tub. So that you could drown it. See, this, what gets lost there is you just want it the size where it is handleable, where it could behave, or we could go into the tub with you, okay? And we're not actually putting the government in the tub. We're just reminding it who's, we're the people, you're the government, behave, or it's into the tub with you. But the real, but the serious number is government as a percentage of GDP, consume half as much in a generation, 25 years. And again, so that you phase this stuff in. There's none of this, you know, fire Fred tomorrow and cut that in half. That doesn't get you where you want to go. And I would argue that when you do these things, look, you want people to be, you want people to be free. You want people to be better off. I'm not sure that the aid to families with dependent children welfare system we had for many years helped a lot of people. I think it hurt a lot of people. I think sometimes when the government stops doing things, it's helpful. I don't consider the sugar subsidy program or the quotas, which keep the price of sugar in the U.S. about twice what the world market is a service provided by the government. I think it's a bad thing and it should be stopped. And so there are the Davis-Bacon Act. Which drives up the cost of every government-funded, paid-for road or building by 25 or 33%. It was explicitly done to keep African Americans out of the New York construction industry back in the 1930s. It was explicitly racist in its intent. The guys in Congress talked about that. I think we should abolish that law. I think it's a bad law. It's a very expensive law, and it's a bad law. So there's a bunch of stuff the government does that's actually unhelpful and destructive. I don't think... I live in D.C. We spend more than $20,000 per child who lives in D.C. in public education. There's not a lot of public education going on. There's not $20,000 worth of it. You know, Obama's kids don't get any more spent on them in his private school than all the other kids in D.C., but they don't have to go to the government-run school, and it doesn't work. So we need to, I think, is you can make government smaller, more effective, and allow competition to drive down costs rather than, you know, what they do in European countries that have Obamacare, which is government rationing. I mean, only two ways, the only part of Obamacare that drops the cost of health care is the rationing part. Nothing else, everything else just raises the cost. All the taxes just raise the cost. I think we should drop the taxes and reduce costs by reducing trial lawyers' ability to loot the system and allowing greater competition in how we approach this stuff. So I think we can get dramatically smaller government without losing anything that you would look at and say that was a service. I don't think paying government employees bigger pensions than people in the private sector get, and higher pay, and more vacation days, and better benefits to be a service provided by the government. I think that's excess money being spent. And I think not spending that money makes the country stronger, not weaker, and at the end of the day, helps everybody, including government employees. I mean, it's not fair to them to have golden handcuffs where they can't get out of jobs that they might want to move from because nobody pays like that in the real world.
We have time for one more question.
How do you reconcile your smaller government at the same time the our party wants to impose legislate all aspects of women's reproductive organs and impose their views on at least half the country who disagrees with them?
Okay. Well, I think you start again, whenever you're working on an issue like this, you start with where are we and where do you want to go? I think the question of should people who don't approve of abortion have to pay for it in taxes? I think, no, I don't think the government ought to be in the business of paying for that. Now, we are so far away from some conversation about forbidding something, that isn't happening. Even the anti-abortion people want to get rid of Roe v. Wade and send it to the 50 states. You think New York is going to ban or restrict abortions? No. You think there's going to be, I mean, where do you think somebody's not going to be able to have their reproductive rights recognized? What you are going to end up with is probably not having the government pay for stuff. And I think that's where you can get reasonable people on both sides to agree that the government ought not to be doing that, or forcing the Catholic hospitals to provide abortions. I mean, that's just, I think, dangerous on the religious liberty issue, whether you like Catholics or not. I still think that's not the approach that you want the government to take. So I think those guys who want to argue that somebody wants to run somebody else's life, okay, Obama's structure wants to tell the Catholic Church how to operate and tell everybody in the country they're paying for something that they may not want to. How about undoing those pressures now? And I think you'll find, I think we'll find a lot more agreement in the future on issues. But that's, those are the guys whose rights are being trampled right now, as opposed to theoretically.
That's great.